Ladies and gentlemen, professional road cycling, a business network perspective. So the road book of my presentation deals with five elements. So I'll try to sketch a bird's eye view on professional cycling by first introducing a business framework. So, and I do have a PhD in economics, but in fact, I'm still more someone specialized in marketing management, which is, in fact, different from economics. Okay, introducing business framework. Then I'll give an overview of international and business development, and very important for a spectator sport, media. And if you analyze cycling, media, oh, there you have doping and doping stories. I try to integrate that in my fourth section. And I'll try to conclude by analyzing the business network. So my analysis deals with two main research questions. So first question, what are the peculiarities of the business network framework of road cycling? And second, what can we learn from an economic and a marketing audit? An intertemporal marketing economic audit, because my research period is period 1990 until 2012. Now, why do we here analyze professional road cycling? Maybe very interesting, but it's one of the first commercial sports that has already been practiced professionally already beginning 20th century. First Tour de France, 1903, were already professional cyclists. End of the 19th century, Track Cycling USA were professional cyclists. I will demonstrate that it's really very popular, atypical popular in Flanders, in comparison with other regions in the world. The sport is growing in other regions in the world, is deepening in Europe and growing outside Europe. And with respect to other spectator sports, like soccer, NBA, tennis, Formula One, it's relatively under-researched. And maybe I do also have a hidden agenda, since, as Romain told, my interest in cycling is indeed quite obsessive. So it helps to study professional road cycling. Good. Introducing business framework. Here I follow, let's say, the classic marketing handbook, Mullen, Hardy, Sutton, and they define a business network or a sports product. If you want to define it, have a look at four elements. First element, what are the characteristics of the players or the teams? What about equipment, apparel? What about venue? What about competition formula? Well, professional cycling has a bit a hybrid nature, because it's not an individual sport, it's not a team sport. So Cadel Evans can't participate in the Tour as an individual. No, his Swiss-based but American management BMC team participates in the Tour. So it's an individual sport, but practiced in teams, implying a lot of things, implying that concepts and models of, for instance, tennis, Formula One, aren't applicable for cycling, or also implying that models for team sports, take soccer, NBA, do not fit here. And also very interesting and atypical is that teams are labeled through the name of the title, through the sponsoring corporate brands. So it is the Australian Orica Greenedge cycling team, or the British Sky Professional team, the Dutch Rabobank team. And in soccer, for instance, City A competes City B, Real Madrid versus Barca. Second component, equipment, apparel. Rather capital incentive in comparison to, for instance, soccer. So in my story which follows, I'll take the comparison, I'll try to compare with soccer. If you compare with soccer, indeed cyclists have to rely on bikes. In a World Tour team, on a year-long basis, 4 bikes, 1 time trial team, 28 a 30 cyclists in a team, so it's rather capital incentives, implying barter trade agreements. BMC is a brand of a frame constructor, or Specialized is sponsoring the Omega Pharma Quickstep team and also other World Tour teams. It's a kind of interesting competition going on between Giant, Cannondale, Trek, Specialized, Belgian Ridley brand. And product placement is really very important here. And product placement, barter trade agreements, and also advanced technical research. We saw some pictures of wind tunnel testing. Very important for the constructors. So cycling is physically a very hard sport. And I don't have a medical background, so here during this Congress, you'll hear very interesting stories dealing with technical medical research. So you have a lot of positive externalities for high incentives for medical research. But also, let's say, typical for endurance sports or power sports, you also have negative externalities in form of high incentives for doping. So next characteristics, the venue. Road cycling is an outdoor sport, but practiced on public ground. So the stage in the Tour de France this afternoon, 214K from Abbeville to Rouen. Implying interesting things. So no entrance fees for the public. You reach a relatively broad public. Also interesting for corporate sponsors, because your visibility has a kind of broad base, a broad public base. But for the organizers, a difficult business model, because no or almost no gate revenues. So the income of the organizers has to come from hospitality, broadcasting, event sponsorship, subsidies. 5 days ago, Tour de France took its grand départ in the province of Liège with the time trial prologue in Liège. But implied an investment of the province of Liège, cash plus barter, so investment in safety and promotion, 4 million euro. For one weekend, a 4 million euro investment. So income for the organizers. And business model of the organizers is relatively very weak. So a weak business model, implying that I wasn't shocked when I heard 2 days ago that the organizer of the Italian week Tirreno Adriatico, second week of March, that he told in a press release, well, we are in financial trouble. Also, we have to look for maybe Milano Sanremo or Tour of Lombardia, not on Saturday, maybe better on Sunday, to obtain more broadcasting rights. And yeah, teams managing a cycling team from a marketing point of view reads sometimes like a horror story, because each year you have to fight for your sponsorship income. If you rely for 95-98%, yeah, that's a crazy story. Cycling is built around a year-long calendar, built by the UCI, the International Federation, but implying that cycling is a combination of non-homogeneous events, a lot of heterogeneity. In fact, Tour de France is 2/3 of cycling. That's quite absurd, these 3 weeks in July. And also between types of races, you have a famous one-day race here in Flanders, first Sunday of April, Tour of Flanders. But you also have a lot of small and very small races. And 2 turning points in the commercialization, in the recent commercialization of professional cycling, are 1989 and 2005. 89, appointment of Hein Verbruggen, Dutch guy, former marketeer with the Master Foods Group, who introduced a lot of marketing novelties. 2005, new competition formula, World Tour, from 2008 onwards, the Pro Tour competition formula, best teams, best cyclists compete in top races. Also, a growing, relatively recent, growing body of knowledge reflected in journal articles dealing with economics, marketing, institutional literature. After introducing my framework, I move into a sketch of an overview of international developments. Well, here we are, André Greipel, the Dutch guy, who won this afternoon the tour stage, wins here a stage in the Tour Down Under. And a German winning a stage Tour Down Under. So, internationalizations, what are the characteristics of this phenomenon? Road cycling is not a global sport. Do not misunderstand Australian and German and other stories. It's not a global sport. There is a kind of gradual international regional development. The sport is deepening in Europe, and there's regional development outside Europe. And I'll try to make my point by way of the next five slides. Let's have a look at cyclists. Cyclists, those on average, you have 1,000 professional cyclists in the world. Now, where do they come from? Okay, they come for a small half of the four core countries. Four core countries, Belgium, France, Spain, Italy, are the core countries of cycling. So from small 60% decrease to 46%. Then you have European countries like the Netherlands, Switzerland, Luxembourg, etc. 15-60%. Then still Europe, new European cycling countries, Russia, Great Britain, etc. Australia, North America, South America, Colombia, etc., Asia, and here, a small part of a percentage, I think, Daniel Titlikamanos of the Greenwich guy, the Eritrean guy. Who knows, 2030, that we'll have another graph with a lot of maybe Africa. Second illustration, where do the teams come from? So actually, you have 18 World Tour teams, Division 1, 22 professional continental teams. First division, second division. Same picture, same story. Core countries, Belgium, France, Italy, Spain. And honestly speaking, if I say Belgium, in fact, that's 85% Flanders. Yeah, because here you have a kind of overshooting of cycling. Again, same story. Europe, Australia, Greenwich, America, American teams, American-based teams, and also Asian teams. Third illustration. I take the two teams, Omega Pharma Quickstep, Lotto Belisol, Quickstep, brand in laminate parquet, national lottery, respectively 14 and 27 years main sponsor of a Pro Tour cycling team. National lottery has a Belgian mission, but still, one-third of the cyclists are non-Belgian. The other Flemish team or Flemish-based team, two-thirds are non-Belgian cyclists. So, internationalization going on. Organization. So, Tour de France is one race, but 21 race days. 2006-2012, here you have the number of races, number of racing days. Outside Europe is the yellow. Still increasing. Relatively small, but increasing. Last illustration, or final illustration, take the Tour de France. 98 edition, a Luxembourger won, Nicolas France, 1909. Greg LeMond, American, 1986, was the first non-European winner. For the Tour of Flanders and Tour of Lombardia, we are still awaiting for the first non-European winner. Who knows, David Cadell, mid-October, Tour of Lombardia, would be historic, Good. Next, a bird's eye view on business developments. Flemish icon, Tom Bonen, specialized frame since this year. I suppose that Fabian Cancellara is still in the yellow jersey with his Trek frame. 40, 50, 60 years ago we had Groene Leeuwen. It's a kind of continuum, namely the frame manufacturers in cycling. Well, it's a quite frustrating exercise for a marketeer, for an economist, to look for economic financial data. Because team budgets sometimes are underestimated, then they are overestimated. Difficult. Maybe salaries of cyclists, is that a better indicator? Or organization budgets, prize money? If you take a look at the current Tour de France going on, 3 million euro prize money. I think they'll, in soccer and tennis, they laugh at these ridiculous amounts, but compared to other spectator sports, still interesting. For the yellow jersey, 450,000 euro prize money. Or prices of VIP packages and broadcasting rights. I'll come to that in my next point. Well, if you take the top 10 best performing teams, beginning of the 90s, budget amounted to a small 4 million euro and increased to actually on average 11 million euro. And you see the dominance of the top three performing best teams diminished. So more than doubling of the budget of the top 10 best performing teams in the world. Say for an economist, that's a significant increase. These are data provided by the UCI, audited by Ernst & Young. Let's say quite reliable data. We take the 40 professional teams and we see a doubling in 10 years. These 321 million euro is the sum, is the total of all 40 team budgets. I know it's a false comparison, but the Real Madrid income budget is 450 million euro. Of if you take the total salary of all top cyclists in the 18 World Tour professional teams, the whole salary mass amounts to the salary mass of the 21 soccer players of Olympique Lyon. Relativity. Well, dependence of sponsorship money. That's not a healthy situation. The business model in cycling is very unstable. Ask Mr. Bob Stapleton, HTC Columbia, a great manager, but he didn't find a continuation of HTC Columbia, etc. Where is he actually? Nobody knows. It's like a crash in the peloton. They look behind and then they fight for the best things. Oh, can I obtain Cavendish or Renshaw? So indeed the adagium of cycling is kill or be killed during races. But unfortunately in management, a lot of ex-cyclists or managers in cycling think also too much in with the same paradigm, kill or be killed. No, you have to cooperate and fight for a better business model. Well, very unhealthy in the business model is the dependence on the Messina's income. Cadel is part of the BMC team, but let's say that Andy Rees, the BMC manager, is a Messina's obsessed by cycling. I do have a lot of doubts between the business model of that relatively small constructor manufacturer, BMC. Omega Pharma Quickstep wouldn't be that performance successful without the 5 million euro of Mr. Bacala. Greenwich is a Mr. Ryan Messina story. The guy, Luxembourg guy of Leopard, Flavio Becca, of the still invests in the Radio Shack Nissan team. Very unhealthy situations. Dependence on multimillionaires. Well, other sources of income, I think 2, 3, 4%. Some merchandise income, some start fees. Ridiculous in the whole business plan. But expenses are there. Let's say 60% is a kind of salary cap, rider staff. Logistics, for cycling very complicated logistics, because transportation, hotels, car fleet, team bus, very difficult, very expensive logistics, legal, administration, you have to organize a service course. Sometimes your World Tour team is competing on 3 different fronts in the world. Try to organize it. You have to be a logistics expert. You have to pay contributions to the UCI, invest in anti-doping policy. So the business model, relatively weak. Now, I'll want to have a look at media and doping from the eyes of a marketeer. So, still, I do not have any medical background, but I try to follow doping cases or cases of contaminated supplements. This is Ilio Keese, Belgian guy, Belgian track specialist, who came a lot into our news headlines with contaminated supplements. We all know this guy. He didn't participate. He didn't start in the Ironman in Nice. We all know why. Vino and Contador. But all very different stories. And if I have a look as a marketeer at these very complex cases, sometimes the doping cases are dark and very dark, but sometimes they are gray, and maybe sometimes they are white. And I'll try to go into that complicated issue now. Well, first, media. There is a very interesting win-win between cycling and media. And if we have a look at the origin of professional cycling, 1903, it was journal Lotto who wanted to block its competitor Le Vélo by organizing the first Tour de France. In 1948, we had the first TV broadcast of the arrival in the Parc des Princes, 64 hours. And then, gradually, Belgium, the Netherlands, some broadcast of highlights. Until now, Tour de France, live images in 60 countries, and highlights in 150 countries on average. But why? Well, the most efficient way to understand the cycling race is to follow it through media. In fact, not as a live spectator, because that's quite frustrating. You zip and cyclists passed. But it's a great spectator sport. It's a television sport, live streaming through the internet, or short messages and to follow cycling. It's a great vehicle for city marketing promotion. Province of Liège did invest 4 million euro to put Liège on the chart of interesting cities. And these 3 weeks in July, again, are very atypical, because we do have, with the exceptions for people following a congress, we do have leisure weeks actually going on. 3 leisure weeks, city marketing, region marketing. In fact, cities, villages compete to obtain the statute to invest in a start or arrival village for the Tour de France. It's a relatively easy to follow sport, which also stimulates social and family spectator behavior. And, very interesting, it's an afternoon spectator sport, implying impressive market shares. In Flanders, 75-80% market share in the afternoon. That's why our public television keeps investing in cycling, a sport which is also part, indeed, of Flemish culture, which is in our genes. However, and then I come back to the venue story. If you want to broadcast soccer, Euro 2012, were great spectator images, but it's relatively easy, NO 2012. Cycling is very complex. You need 2-3 helicopters, a lot of motors, a relatively high cost of production, relatively very complex to broadcast. And we have to guess how much broadcasting rights do we have. I'll come back to this later. But that's a great shame. If I do have a mission today, and if I want to communicate something, that's in fact the heart of the matter. Cycling is physically a very hard sport. It's indeed a very dangerous sport. But it's a shame that only the shareholders of the ISO group organizing Tour de France know how much broadcasting rights are. But I'll come back to this later. Well, some data, Tour de France, and I'll show some figures. France on a relatively high stable viewing figures. Germany, the Ulrichtzabel drop, the post-Ulrichtzabel drop. And we come back on a lower level. And I'm convinced maybe the first question in the room will be in my direction or Dave's direction regarding doping, Germany, who knows. The drop in the post-LA array, yeah, Flanders, on a relatively high level for a small region, steady growth, are some interesting data, and indeed, David Green, Australia. Yeah. Now, Flanders equals cycling, cycling equals Flanders. It's a quote of Lance Armstrong. But if you have a look at Flemish public television, at the coverage of cycling, very interesting is that 350, 300 hours live broadcast, but let's say here 140 racing days. Well, for someone following quite passionate media data in cycling, September the 3rd, 2008 was for me a great day because in that afternoon, Wednesday afternoon, Flemish public television, who has quite a specialization in cycling, succeeded in broadcasting directly broadcasting images from others, though directly three races. A relatively small classic in the neighborhood of Antwerp, a stage in the Tour of Poland, and a stage in the Tour of Vuelta. So Flanders may be the only origin where in the top 10 of sports programs with the highest density, you do not only have six soccer programs, but also four cycling races. So that's very atypical and interesting. But now I try to integrate the doping story, the doping issue into my story. Well, starting from Simpson to the Thero, Cinco story of Alberto Contador, the poor guy who is not allowed to participate today. The sport copes still with a harsh negative doping perception image. And with the Brussels colleague, we worked on public opinion and cycling. First, preliminary results are interesting because we noticed that respondents ask for zero tolerance. No discussion, but there's a lot of confusion. Indeed, if you have a look at respondents who are not familiar, who do have a limited knowledge of doping and a limited knowledge of cycling, they confuse almost everything. They think that never suspended racers have been suspended. And also interesting, people with some or a lot of doping knowledge or with a lot of cycling knowledge feel that cyclists are discriminated in a multi-sports context, or women and middle-aged or older age groups do attach, for instance, a lot of importance to the health argument. But I'd like to present in a nutshell an average of 2 years data from the Flemish doping authority. In fact, when I first saw and worked on this data, I was a bit surprised myself too. Yeah? I was not surprised by the fact that bodybuilding tops the list. No, it was not a surprise for me. But cycling, doping sensitiveness, positive doping cases, 1.95%. And here you take the average of recreative and competitive professional cycling. Number 23. But if I have a look, so, and it's an extremely hard-controlled sport. Let's say almost, or 1,700 controls in 2 years with 33 positive cases. And yes, I know that you can't have been positively controlled and have taken doping during a whole career. I know that issue. But that the same arguments holds for the other sports too, I think. But if you have a look now at Flemish journals, you analyze them, we analyze them for 2011, articles with doping in the title. And here you see really an overshooting, cycling tops by very far the list. Almost 60%, and we are here now in Bruges. You have a famous soccer team here, FC Bruges. Well, they missed collectively whereabout on the 9th of August last year, but nobody cared. A cyclist has to be extremely careful, and I think that's a very good thing. So this negative perception has to do with the fact that UCI has, and I support that, a strict, proactive, repressive anti-doping policy. We have to say, people following cycling, that the UCI has a forefront position with respect to athlete biological passports, with respect to no-needle policy. I think a lot of cooperation with respect to whereabouts, that's a very good thing. But the media overexposure is a very strange, it's a very interesting thing. I think there is a lot of competition between media in a 24/7 economy. In Flanders, there is really a market for doping stories. It's the bold and beautiful of the sport. Does he or doesn't he dope? That's an interesting question. It's the bold and beautiful because doping cases seem to correspond to expectations of the public. Unfortunately, being a corporate brand, you really have a huge problem and may be very reluctant to invest in that dirty spot with that huge perception problem. And it may be quite ironic, maybe, that we now live in an array where the number of cheaters may have been never that low. You see, I'm very conditional, May have been never that low. But the doping perception problem remains very harsh. Final section, business network. Well, Flanders was in shock mid-September last year because it was one of the headlines in the news, next to the Euro banking crisis and a geopolitical crisis. The organizers of the Tour of Flanders decided to change the arrival village from Meerbeke to Oudenaarde. So to illustrate, Flanders equals cycling. Well, business network, you have the regulatory body, UCI, and you have organizations, media groups. As the most, the main important is the ISO Amaury Sport Organisation, is the main one. Now, who should govern cycling? Well, in theory, it should be the UCI. In the eyes of the IOC and the sports movement, it has to be the Union Cycliste Internationale. However, in practice, it is the French media group who influences in a decisive way cycling. And cycling is a kind of private sector sport. The power struggle deals with a core economic conflict, dealing with who owns TV rights, and a secondary conflict with marketing rights. And cycling is for two-thirds Tour de France. And how much are... There isn't any transparency regarding broadcasting rights. I'm still awaiting for a kind of lockout. Sometimes the World Tour teams have to say in block, we want to know how much broadcasting rights are. And we want a distribution key because we are the actors in a very hard and dangerous sport, but still no distribution. Let me conclude. Things changed a lot. Indeed, international regional development. So no globalization. Cycling is not a global sport. Significant increase and an impressive increase in respectively team budgets, media coverage. Finally, we do have a zero-tolerance anti-doping policy. However, we notice kind of surplus, standstill. Teams remain sponsorship addicted. Business model is very weak, and that's why there is still a persistence of messiness. Cycling, two-thirds Tour de France, the hot topic of TV money. The doping image is a great problem, and media groups rule the world. My final slide, I'm a marketeer, so small commercial. This is my latest handbook, unfortunately not published in English, but in Dutch. Deals with sport marketing communicatie. It's the skyline of Qatar, Tour of Qatar, January 2010. As I told earlier, there are new promising regions on the cycling map. Southeast Australia, or St. Louis, Argentina, Beijing. Outside Europe, deepening also in Europe. California is also an interesting growth pool. Within the core countries, France, Spain, Italy, Belgium, I think that cycling will remain incontournable. So in my opinion, I think the future of the business model of professional road cycling looks bright. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Wim. I have a few announcements first before we start the discussion. First of all, that our rector has arrived, so this is very good news. Second of all, you had the summer for Belgium because the thunderstorm is already present. Third of all, there will be a special symposium later this week where Lotto will have an interaction with the Australian Institute of Sport and three legendary, famous, good speakers of the Australian Institute of Sport will interact on cycling. And we have now I'll give you one housekeeping message. Please respect your colleagues. If you want to chat with your colleagues, don't do it in front of this door because I found that it was a bit disturbing. Who has questions for our two speakers? Can we have some lights on, please? If you have a question, please go to the microphone, identify yourself, and shoot. So I can start. If we think at Cadel Adams as a product, how good a product is he? And that's probably for Wynne, the question.
He's a bit old, isn't he? 35, old product.
Well, he's relatively old.
Still a good, reliable car, but just got a lot of miles on it. Yeah.
Sometimes I do have the impression that his wife, Chiara, does have more PR power than Cadel does. So his PR power is relatively weak. And that may be an understatement, David. But he's a great athlete. So for solid brands, there may be a good brand fit. For serious brands, he's also very serious. But he has a sometimes disturbed relations with mass media. Mm. I think he still needs some media coaching. Mm. And maybe you can supplement, David?
Yeah, fortunately for me, I'm not a media coach. It's funny when we watch the professional basketball players, the professional rugby players in Australia. I'm amazed at how some of those athletes interact with kids, with women, with moms, how after their games they come by and they interact with the fans. They say the right thing on TV. I'm incredibly impressed with how polished they are, and often unimpressed with professional cyclists. Get out of my way, I've got to get to the van, you're a nuisance, back off, you know. And it just seems like we haven't really nailed the interaction. Like in tennis, the game finishes, well, Wimbledon, and they have those lovely interactions, well, and they warm the crowd, where we seem to miss that a bit with cycling.
But there I think that the American-Australian guys, and let's say one of the front runners was Lance Armstrong, who has an exceptional PR power. Yeah. Yeah. Maybe who never got media training, but who has it?
Yeah. I was wondering, what do you think prevents these multimillionaires? When are we going to have Oprah Winfrey come in and Gates and the big boys come in and take on a professional cycling team? I always wonder, it's a pretty risky proposition, yet some still do it. And I wonder what aspects of cycling would make more want to do it until the sport starts to stabilize economically in other ways.
Well, the business model is very weak, and the only solution may come from broadcasting rights. I think there isn't any growth anymore on the issue of hospitality. There you still have a very small growth margin, but indeed, maybe that the sport waits still also for the Abramovich and other guys. Eh? Yeah. But these guys are already for a bit in cycling. So, but that's not a healthy situation.
I see no one approaching the microphone, so, and in the lack of time, I think I can conclude this session with a present for the speakers.
Oh, beautiful.
Whatever. And of course, this was meant to be for our rector, so we like to drug our rector with beer. That's also good. Thank you.